Well, one of the exchanges from a raucous, crowded, sometimes wandering English language leaders debate last night. Yesterday on this program, three colleagues from the Parliamentary Press Gallery joined me to look ahead to the debate. They're back today to give us their assessments 24 hours later and to talk about what went on. Manon Cornellier is an editorial writer with Le Devoir. Bob Fife is the Parliamentary Bureau Chief for the Globe and Mail. And John Ivison is a columnist with the National Post and Parliamentary Bureau Chief for Postmedia. Good to see you all.
Thanks.
So, initial observations. Was it everything you expected?
We told you so.
Yeah. Bob, start us off.
Well, look, I thought it was a terrible debate. You, as we said yesterday, six people, five moderators. It didn't work. There was a lot of talking over. You couldn't hear what people were saying because it was so difficult for the moderators to control the debate. You also had Maxime Bernier and the Bloc leader there, who really, in many ways, are irrelevant to what is going on in English Canada. And the fact of the matter is that there are only two people who have a possibility of forming a majority government, and that is Mr. Trudeau, or a government rather, and that's Mr. Trudeau and Mr. Scheer, and they really didn't have an opportunity for Canadians to really assess them because the format was so bad. So my view on this was that I thought that Jagmeet Singh did the best performance of all the leaders. I thought that Andrew Scheer did very well. And Mr. Trudeau held his own. But if were there any real winners in this? No, I think the loser were the Canadian public.
Manon, what are your thoughts?
I find that it was messy, it was noisy, it was there was a lot of, we say in French, cacophonie.
Yeah.
You know, people were talking over each other. What really annoyed me too, they were the segment where they were asking a question, each leader was answering, but without being able to reply to the other, even if they were attacked. So I find it unfair. There was no second question just to remind a leader to, that's not the question, you're not answering.
Right, a chance to follow up and say.
Yeah, a moderator.
Seconds. How can you answer something for
Yeah, yes. They ask Mr. Scheer, you know, how are you going to take into account the United Nations Declaration on the Indigenous People, how are we, and so on and so on. And he say, I'm sorry, 40 seconds is too short to go through this. And he was right.
Yeah.
And but I find there was a team that if people have not followed this campaign all along and were just getting into it, it made clear the difference on the environment. They have on four of the five segments, people they end up.
Yeah, climate change kept looping its way back into every conversation.
Into the debate. Yeah. And I think that there people were able to see the difference between the conservative and the rest of the bunch.
This was supposed to be a step up for voters, John. And
we could
spend a lot of time just talking about what didn't work. But I mean, ultimately, what you're trying to do is serve Canadian voters. Watch tonight, and you'll get all the answers you need. Did it live up to any of that?
No, I mean, I think it's kind of ironic that we're seeing a decline in trust for political parties at the same time as we're seeing extreme polarization. I mean, you would think that those two things would not work, go together. But, you know, people did not emerge. I don't think people emerged feeling that they saw somebody they could trust who had a vision for the country. You know, as Bob said, we didn't see the two guys who could be prime minister debating what they would do differently. I mean, the only person who came out of it relatively well, I thought, was Jagmeet Singh. I think that if we're looking for numbers to move, his are the only numbers I would suspect would move as a result of that debate. And that was really just because he was a genial, agreeable figure on the stage. You know, he came up with
in the midst of all the screaming and yelling, he had some good one-liners.
He had a great line on climate change. You know, he referred to Mr. Trudeau as Mr. Delay and Mr. Scheer as Mr. Deny. And today, at Ryerson University, he was mobbed by young people, mobbed. And, you know, a few days ago, he went to McGill and nobody paid attention to him. So people who watch that debate, young people, because I think it's probably the environment that's moved them to come out. This has got to be a concern to Mr. Trudeau, because if part of that young vote feels that they're more comfortable with Mr. Singh rather than Mr. Trudeau, that means the difficulty for him to get a majority government is not there.
I think that what will happen now, though, is the scrutiny will be on Singh because it has not been.
It's not been.
And maybe he's missed a deficit.
But you know what had me thinking today, to Bob's point, watch, you know, if there's somebody who's demonstrated some continual growth, it's Jagmeet Singh. Had me thinking, here's a guy probably wishing it was a 78-day campaign.
Yes.
You know, because we watched what happened to Justin Trudeau in 2015.
In 2011, 1 week before the leader's debate, Jack Layton was at 13%.
Right.
A week after it, he was at 25%. Right. It doesn't take long.
No, and the debate changed a lot.
The debate changed everything. But I think my point on Singh was that he released his platform in the summer, and really nobody's looked at it since then. I went to look at it today. It turns out the fiscal approach at the back does not have any numbers in it. He does not have a costed platform. And people are now going to start asking him questions.
Picking, John.
I know. And even on the environment, I read all the platforms.
You and your concerns about money and dollars.
The 1% wealth tax, which he's got, is going to raise, I mean, even the parliamentary budget officer says it could raise $5.5 billion. But there's a big warning sign on it saying this is going to cause behavioral change, and it probably won't.
Yeah. Let's.
And I look at and I think Mr. Scheer had the same problem. His full platform is not out. Now we have the full platform of the NDP for months, and I went through it. And when you look at the environment plan, it doesn't have the precision that you can find, for example, with the Green, which is quite idealistic in a sense. But and there's no numbers, and there's proposal in there. Can be really costly. And I don't think they can go through until the end of the campaign without releasing a cost of all their proposal, at least the main one.
It may not matter to some of these people if their view is they're not going to vote. They're not going to vote for Scheer in any case.
Yeah.
The last time around, everybody liked Trudeau. If they've decided that
it should be said, Bob, too, on very little scrutiny, right up through the end of the campaign,
nobody
thought he was going to win. There he is, he's the Prime Minister of Canada.
So if these young people are saying, you know, I don't, and that youth vote is important because it went up so much in the last election campaign and really made a big difference for the Liberals. If they are saying, to hell with the Liberals, we're more comfortable supporting Mr. Singh. That is a problem for the Liberals.
Because that was one of the, we talked about this yesterday, one of the objectives had to be for Justin Trudeau last night was to reach out to those other progressive voters with the NDP and Greens and try to give them no option. Yeah. You have to come to me.
He's playing on those who are on the fence and who at the same time said we want action on the environment, but we won't want to break the bank. And maybe and Mr. Trudeau is playing that card. You know, I'm more realistic, I'm more pragmatic. They may be more too idealistic. And so, and if I don't win, then you will end up with Scheer. So he's playing this card like I'm not perfect, but maybe I'm the best of the
two. And now he's likely to, thanks to John, he's likely to say, look at the NDP platform and see if you can find their cause.
The NDP as well, though, they've fallen way behind. They got nearly 20% of the vote last time. They're currently around about 14. So even if their vote goes up, they're only back to where they were.
Right. Let me stick with Jagmeet Singh for a second, because he may have sort of moved his position a little bit in the last 24 hours on Bill 21 in Quebec, which came up a lot in the debate last night, too. He's now saying, you know, I'm not going to get involved. But then again, if I'm Prime Minister and it makes it all the way to the Supreme Court of Canada, then I might have to give it a look. Mm-hmm. And he's taking some heat today from different minority organizations about his position on this, and he should be more forceful and more vocal on this. How are the leaders dealing with this, Manon, and from a Quebec perspective here in particular? Is this just all about protecting seats in the province of Quebec?
I think so. Mr. Trudeau, people in Quebec know where he's coming from and where he stands, and so they're not surprised by his position. So what he has to lose in terms of support for that, he has already lost it. But the others are all in a kind of shaky position, especially with the rise of the Bloc. So they're trying to contain the damage.
But I had a guest earlier on my show say, look, this is the only racialized leader in the campaign. If anybody needs to stand up to what's happening in Quebec, if they disagree with the law, it has to be this guy.
That's
and
why
he's
Mr.
not.
Trudeau went after him yesterday.
Yeah, and is that effective?
Subject. I'm not sure that he will get more support in Quebec because of this position.
And he's very low at the moment. It would seem to be that he doesn't have that much to lose. He's around about 10% in Quebec.
I think an English candidate would make a lot of sense for him to speak out on that issue.
Right, but he's got 14 seats in Quebec. He's trying to hang on to But the polling suggests that every one of them is vulnerable.
Yeah. But to your point, Peter, if there's anybody who should be saying that this law is discriminatory, it is a guy like Jagmeet Singh. He does say that. But he won't. He could be saying, if I was prime minister today,
I'd be bankrolling that court case in Quebec, or I would be an intervener in it in the province of Quebec because I think it's wrong, and we would stand up for it with all the political consequences that would entail.
I mean, I guess they were bitten last time, and that's probably why he's being counseled not to.
Yeah, that hurt Tom Mulcair's position on NICAB in Quebec.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so what do you watch for now as we're now into the last 10 days or so here, a little more than 10 days? John, you're going out on the road again. It's going to be busy.
Yeah. It seems to me that Andrew Scheer is having a really hard time getting that last 4 or 5% of the vote, particularly in Ontario, that he needs to kind of go over the top. And I think we were talking earlier about the environment position and his position in foreign aid and other positions being seen as being too right-wing for many centrist voters who are now desperately looking around for somewhere else to go, and they're not really finding a home. I could see Singh's numbers going up, but again, I don't see a breakthrough like we saw with Layton. That came through Quebec. This is obviously not coming through Quebec.
Andrew Scheer might be hoping, if you talk about Ryerson University students today, Bob. So Andrew Scheer's probably keeping his fingers crossed for that. I hope Jagmeet Singh rises in Ontario.
But then we have two parties on 33% to 35% and one on 20%.
But if he's gaining more support in the province of Ontario, that helps Scheer, right?
For sure.
Many of these ridings.
You know, I still think we're looking at a liberal minority government, probably a strong liberal minority government. The challenge for Mr. Trudeau is try to get those green progressive voters that are parked now with the Greens and the NDP to come over and give them a majority. And the Liberals have been successful in the past doing that by scaring people and saying, if you don't do this, the Conservatives are going to win. So that will be what we have to watch for.
Maybe that's the byproduct of last night, is that the NDP voters are less likely to do that now.
I'm not sure of that.
Yeah, you think they still will?
I think the Greens
will. It was
a
messy debate, so most people were like, I don't know what to get from that.
And that's just the four people around this table.
We had to watch it.
We had to, All right.
So I'm not sure that this debate yesterday will move the needle.
Okay, so we still have a campaign and where they look deadlocked, and we're not sure whether the dial's been moved, and who knows what will happen over the next...
But Thanksgiving weekend is important, right?
Yes.
So after Thanksgiving weekend, we should watch to see if the polls move.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.